Good afternoon, children of 11th class bio group. Today, as you know, we are continuing with the second chapter of biology, which is systematics and five kingdom of life. And last time we named three major categories of classification, which are artificial system of classification, natural system of classification, and phylogenetic system of classification. And today we would be looking at all three systems of classification. One by one, we will be looking at these three systems of classification. Let us take the first system, which is artificial classification. Artificial system of classification is based upon one or a few easily observable characteristics. So we take just a few observable characteristics that can be observed by the naked eye from outside and has been used for limited purpose where convenience and speed are important. For example, an artificial classification of fish would be to group them as freshwater fish, brackish water fish, and marine fish on basis of environment, mechanisms of osmoregulation, etc. Osmoregulation is the control of salinity or the control of salt, the presence of salt in the body. So we see that artificial classification is very superficial, and we just look at the outside observations. We look at the outside characteristics of individuals. We see, for example, the classification of plants into four groups: herbs, and then under shrubs, shrubs and trees, on the basis of their habit, by Theophratus. This system of classification or artificial classification conveys very little information. The second system of classification, we are looking at the natural system of classification. In natural system of classification, we base this type of classification on large number of characters. This increases the amount of information available from the groupings. In this kind of classification, we see that more information is gathered from the different groupings that are classified one after the other in a systematic manner. Then we see the third type of classification is the phylogenetic system of classification. A phylogenetic system of classification reflects possible evolutionary relationships based on ancestry and descent. So in this class of classification, we look at the ancestry, we look at the descent, from which organism the other organisms have descended. So this means, in such a system, organisms belonging to the same group are believed to have a common ancestry. They are believed to have a common ancestor from which they have branched out. So in this, we will study about cladogram. We see that cladogram is such organisms which may be represented in the form of a family tree. Do you see here the family tree that is being shown? So cladogram is such a representation of organisms which are represented in the form of a family tree, and this family tree which is represented is known as cladogram. And this cladogram shows the common ancestry of all these branches of animals that are shown. Now, we will talk about a phonetic classification. Our phonetic classification is based upon numerical evaluation of similarity between groups of organisms. And ordering of these groups into higher ranking taxa on the basis of their similarities. What is a phonetic classification? This phonetic classification is based upon a numerical evaluation of similarities between groups of organisms and ordering of these groups into higher ranking taxa or groups on basis of their similarities. And where do we see? In a pattern which is known as dendrogram. On a pattern which is known as dendrogram. We will look at the dendrogram. Dendrogram, here we see, is a family tree based upon the phonetic classification. So, the family trees that are made based on the phonetic classification or evaluation between the similarities of different groups. So, this is seen in a dendrogram. Now, we will come at the study of taxonomy and phylogeny. And if you remember, what is taxonomy or what the taxonomist study? Now, taxonomy is a branch of biological science which deals with naming of organisms or the nomenclature and placing them in groups or categories according to a particular plan of classification. So this is taxonomy, and the taxonomist, they not only name the organisms but they also categorize them in groups. Then let's see what the phylogenists do. The phylogenists, they explore the evolutionary relationships among organisms and seek to reconstruct evolutionary history. What do? The phylogenists, they explore the evolutionary relationships among organisms, how they have evolved, from which organisms they have evolved. So they see the relationships during the evolution of various organisms, and the phylogenists seek to reconstruct the evolutionary history of these organisms. So we see that taxonomists and phylogenists, they work together so that products of their work is compatible, or the product of their work can be understood in balance with each other's work. So that taxonomists reflects the evolutionary relationships between organisms, and phylogenists they use several evolutionary evidences like fossils. The phylogenists, they use comparative anatomy, they use life cycle information and biochemical or molecular evidences. You would study these in great detail in class 12th. So we see what is important here in taxonomy and phylogeny and in the study of classification. What is important here is another line of evidences useful to phylogenists and taxonomists comes from the field of developmental biology. What happens? Another line of evidences useful to phylogenists and taxonomists come from the field of developmental biology. Recent advances in DNA, deoxyribonucleic acid analysis, is used to determine genetic similarities among the species. So this has been used most latest. Then we see how we take the guidelines for classification. What are the guidelines that we go across while classification is done? Morphological characteristics of organisms, first we see, have been used extensively both for classification diagnostic purpose and are indispensable to taxonomists. So we see that the first guideline that the taxonomists or the phylogenists they take for the classification of organisms is morphological characteristics of organisms. These are extensively used and are very important. Then the second guideline they use is morphological external study, and this is alone not good enough. So as it is inadequate, so recent research workers have shown that contribution to systematics of classification come from other biological branches. Now let's see what are the different biological branches which should be taken as guidelines. Information is obtained from morphology, anatomy, cytology, genetics, paleontology, ecology, from geomorphology, from geographical distribution, physiology, biochemistry, developmental biology, behavior, reproduction, homology of macromolecules, and body structure of organisms for classification. Then we see the fourth guideline which the taxonomists follow is the chemotaxonomy and the chemical taxonomy. What are these? These are by the application of chemistry to contribute to the classification along with cytogenetics, etc. The science of studying cells and the genetics, genes, these are utilized for the classification of animals or plants. Then the fifth guideline is numerical taxonomy, develops methods both in evaluation of taxonomic relationships and in laying down of taxa. What are taxa? These are groups. So we see that this is used. Now we see that there are hierarchical taxonomic groups. If we look into our book and the text part that I had sent to you, we will see that there are various hierarchical taxonomic groups that we see here on page number 30 and 31. And these hierarchical taxonomic groups, they have got three significance. Hierarchy means a group of things ranked one above the other. So we see that these ranks are ranked one above the other. Here, one by one, these are ranked on top of each other. Classification involves the hierarchy of steps. So these all divisions or the groups, they would be put in a certain hierarchy of steps. In this, each step represents a rank or category. And the third aspect that we see here in hierarchical taxonomical groups is that each category, each of these categories, they refer to a unit of classification representing a rank, commonly called taxon, or the plural of taxon is taxa, the definition of which we have already studied. Now, let us take the various taxonomic groups. We see the various taxonomic groups can be enumerated as kingdom. Under the kingdom comes division or phylum. Under the division of phylum come class, then comes order, then comes family, then comes genus, and then comes species. Now, let us discuss all these units one by one. Kingdom is the largest unit of classification. Here you see, we see the kingdom. Kingdom is the largest unit of classification. For example, plants and animal kingdoms both come under kingdom. The division or phylum, the next, what do we have? we have the division or the phylum. This is the next unit, the unit of classification. This comes next to the kingdom and represents organisms belonging to different classes. For example, for plants. For plants, we use the unit division. For plants, we use the unit division in plants, like division, embryo phyta, siphogamma of angiosperm includes classes dicotyledony and monocotyledony. Then, if we take animals as example, we see that the animal in the animals, the unit used is phylum in place of division. The phylum consists of classes like fishes, amphibians, reptiles, birds, and mammals based on phylum chordata. What does chordata mean? Those having notochord or spinal column. Then we see that after the division of the phylum comes class. Under division and phylum comes classes. For example, in plants, class dicotyledony of angiosperms has several orders like renales and parsitales and rosales, etc. Whereas in animals also we can see example. In animal kingdom, class mammalia will have order primates having many different species, humans, monkeys, gorilla and gibbon. Then we see comes the unit order after class. This unit order, which comes after class, contains groups of closely related families. You will see in this diagram that the order contains groups of families. We see that the groups of closely related families are taken together. In plants, families Convolvulaceae and Solanaceae are placed under order Polymoniales. Then in animals, we see in order Carnivora. Carnivore means those which eat flesh. The families included in this are Felidae and Canidae. These are the families included under order Carnivora. Then we see here comes the next unit, family. Family under a single order, there are several families that can come. Family has genera under them. Example, plants, legume family. In plants, let us take legume family or Fabaceae. In Fabaceae, this family consists of several genera of pulses, like pisum stands for pea, glycine stands for soybean, and then we see that fasciolus stands for beans, etc. We see that in animals also we can give examples of families. Family Felidae has several genus, like genus Panthera for lion, genus Tiger or leopard along with Felis is in cats. So we see here these families. Then we come to the sixth unit, which is genus. This unit, genus, comes after family, and the category has groups of related species under them. So we see here we have groups of related species under the unit genus. In plants like potato and brinjal, there are different species, but both belong to the genus Solanum. Potato and brinjal, they are different species, but they both belong to the genus Solanum. Also in animals we can see the example that lion is called Panthera leo and leopard is called Panthera pardus and the tiger is called Panthera tigris. So we see that all lion, leopard and tiger, they belong to the genus Panthera. What we see that all three, the lion, leopard and tiger, although they have got different species here, but they belong to the same genus Panthera. Then we come to species, which is the last unit. This is the last and basic taxonomic unit in classification. Example in plants, Solanum tuberosum or potato has species tuberosum coming after genus Solanum. Another Solanum molengena has species molengena different coming under the same genus Solanum. And if we see an example of animals in Panthera pardus, which is leopard, and Panthera tigris, which is tiger, the species pardus and tigris, they come under the same genus Panthera. So we see in this video how the taxonomical hierarchy takes place. And in the next video, we would come across further study of identification of species, what are the keys that are used for identification species, and we will follow with two kingdom classification and so on. So till then, children, wish you all the best and God bless you. Thank you.